Alrighty, everyone, welcome to Lowell Observatory. My name is Claire and I have my colleague Wesley here with us this evening.
Hi, I'm Claire's colleague Wesley.
Sweet. And we're going to host interactive stargazing for you guys. So we have an exciting night. We're back after a long couple months of having cloudy weather and just generally adverse weather here. So we're excited to be back and show you guys some cool things. It's been a while, so we have lots of new objects to show you guys.
Whole different sky.
Yeah, completely different sky. We have just so many things. And so to start you off, we have a pretty cool galaxy to show you. And this is actually the second closest major galaxy to us. It's called the Triangulum Galaxy or the Pinwheel Galaxy. Goes by both, super confusing. Why can't astronomers just pick one name for something? Would be way easier.
To make it even better, there's another galaxy that also is called the Pinwheel Galaxy. And it's sort of a toss-up whether any given catalog of galaxies will list this one or that one as the Pinwheel Galaxy. It's always very fun. Usually they at least don't call them both the Pinwheel Galaxy, but sometimes they do.
Our software says this is called the Pinwheel Galaxy.
Oh, good.
So we're just going to go with that. But anyway, this galaxy is about 2.7 million light years away from us. It's pretty far, but pretty close considering all things in the universe. And it's a nice spiral galaxy that we're looking at face down. So you can start to see those spiral arms arcing off of the image on the top and bottom and sides. Then we have that nice bright galactic center. Then there's also these little tendrils of dark stuff. And that's a bunch of gas and dust that is obscuring the many trillions, perhaps billions of stars from behind it and creating that nice detail that we see.
That is a way too intense name. The process of dust making stars look dimmer is called interstellar extinction, which is just way too fanciful of a name for there's some dust in the way.
It is very dramatic. I remember learning about that at school and I was like, this is very dramatic for
my favorite thing was walking into Nadine Barlow's class and interstellar extinction was like on the list of things we're gonna cover. And I was like, oh, that sounds sounds so cool. And then it was just that if there's dust in the way, it's harder to see it.
Nice. That's pretty cool. Well, we thought we'd just start you off with something big and flashy, but it looks like we already have some objects coming in to the chat.
Dylan,
you guys have
show us Fomalhaut. Fomalhaut. I think that's a typo. I think there's an N in there. Show us Fomalhaut, Dylan. Bring us to the star Fomalhaut. It's, yep, there we go. That's the one.
Perfect. This is a nice bright star in the southern sky for us, I believe.
And we're going to go ahead and switch to video view here. Normally, we're taking sort of long exposure pictures, but Fomalhaut's really, really bright. So here it is. It's really pretty.
Oh, just that little guy.
Just that little guy. It's actually extremely, extremely, extremely big, but
that's true.
Yeah, it's just that little guy.
Do you know how big it is?
I do not know how big it is. Let's see.
It's a pretty nice star. So we switched to video mode just because stars are so bright, and this one you can easily see with your naked eye. And so
18th brightest star in the night sky, Claire.
Hey, that's like pretty good.
Looks like it's estimated its radius is 796,270 miles.
Nice.
Why would you list this in miles? That's horrible. The imperial system is awful, folks. The imperial system is terrible. We need to go to the metric system now.
To put
Dylan,
that in
would you kick up the gain too much really quick for me?
Just a little bit.
Just too much. Yeah, give it too much gain. There we go. Yeah.
Nice. So what the gain does on the camera, it's basically just telling the camera how sensitive to light it should be. So right now, when we're moving that bar towards a higher number, it's going to be super sensitive. And so it'll make some things really bright and kind of bring out background stars that we wouldn't be able to see with a lower gain. So it has its benefits. Sometimes it doesn't have its benefits, so that's why we can change it, and we'll be using that tool throughout the night. But just to put this star's brightness, so it's the 18th brightest star in the sky, into a comparison, the North Star, or Polaris, is like the 49th brightest star in the sky. Which is kind of sad, because the North Star is such a well-known star. It's very important for navigation, for finding your north. But it's not a very bright star, so it is often mistaken for other objects in the night sky because of that. So just a fun fact, if you see a really faint star, chances are, could be Polaris, especially if you're looking north.
Logan Moody wants to know if we can see Venus tonight. Dylan, what's the story? Do you think we can see Venus? it's pretty low on the horizon. Usually you want to be like just after sunset for that one, or just before sunrise, but we're at the part in Venus's orbit where it's just after sunset. So it may be either down or behind the trees right now.
Looks like we just got word that Venus is too low for us, yeah. Probably behind a tree. So we won't be able to see it from our vantage point here. We have another one for, is the nova in Cassiopeia visible? Let's try it. It's a
looks
maybe
like we
for
have
us.
A maybe.
Yeah, we have a little color-coded chart that we're looking at that'll tell us if we can or cannot possibly see it, but we're gonna try. So for this one, because it's not an object that is regularly in the night sky, we're gonna input the actual coordinates for this object called RA in deck, or right ascension and declination. So our telescope operator right now is typing all those numbers in, and the telescope will slew to that exact position in the night sky.
It's also in what looks like kind of a time notation, which sounds insane because generally in all the sciences, we just do things in decimal, but it's actually really, really useful because it'll tell you things about where it is in the night sky and when it'll be up and when it'll be where, because we humans still operate in this sexagesimal notation for time, funnily enough, which was invented by the Egyptians.
Oh, I did not know that. The more you learn.
The more you learn.
So we're going to go there and then we're going to see what we can see. Novas are pretty cool phenomena in the universe. They're not something that they're pretty rare, pretty exotic in some ways. And they're usually extremely bright objects in the night sky. So we're kind of looking in here. We're not sure exactly which pinpoint of light it is.
Oh, yeah. It looks like we're probably not going to be able to see this. I think okay. It's got brightest back in May.
Okay.
And these things are not... The one that I remember vividly is when we took that picture of one in back in June, and Claire or Hannah and Rezzy used the 17-inch plane wave to take spectras of it, which is really, really cool. I think that was one of the first times we did that. Yeah, anyway, that was naked eye visible for like maybe 2 days, and then it was telescope visible for like a week, and now I don't think you can see it anymore. It's totally gone. So I would suspect that this is probably... the same story?
We know it's in the field at least, but we're just not sure which one it is. And it's likely that it's probably not one of the brighter stars in there. So
it's probably very, very dim. Yes. Claire, do you want to tell them what a nova is?
Yeah, well, a nova, it involves a white dwarf star in the night sky. What a white dwarf star, it's a very dense old dead core of a star that has shed all of its outer layers out into space. So in many billions of years, our own sun will become a white dwarf star once it completely runs out of fuel and is no longer able to do regular star things. But the special thing about this specific white star is it's gonna be in a star system with a regular star that is able to do regular star things, like create energy from fusion in its core. Now the white dwarf star will actually begin to accrete material onto it, and that material will be able to ignite the hydrogen on the surface of the white dwarf. This is kind of a complicated thing, but it's super cool anyway, so I'm going to tell you about it. It'll reignite the hydrogen on the sphere of that white dwarf so that it can do hydrogen into helium. That hydrogen to helium is a super important reaction that occurs in the universe. Basically, all the stars, or at least most of them, that we can see in the night sky are going through that converting hydrogen to helium reaction, including our own sun. It's how we get most of the energy in the universe. So it's a very important thing. When that white dwarf starts it up again on that surface, it'll just basically flash incredibly bright, and it won't last for very long, as Wesley kind of just explained, where it'll dim over time. But novas are a recurring reaction. So in a certain amount of time, I'm not sure how long, that star will probably reignite into a nova again, because it will still continue to accrete material from its binary star pair, which is pretty cool. And so novas don't happen very often, especially ones that happen pretty close to us where we can see it with our own naked eyes, as we were able to back earlier this year. So it's a pretty cool thing that we can see. Very interesting to study. But that is what a nova is. So
really, really cool. We have a request from Tom Sarko. Dylan, would you go to M27, the Dumbbell Nebula, for me, please?
Nice. Ooh. I knew we were going to get a dumbbell request. Can't miss out on that.
It's a good one. It's a very good one. Very picturesque.
Indeed. very colorful. This is also a dead star in the night sky. There's also a white dwarf featured in this object, so we're getting lots of white dwarf action right now.
They're really, really cool.
They are really cool. I agree.
So this is what generally happens with stars like these. So this was once a star that was probably somewhere around the same category of mass as our sun, so an average-ish star. And what happens with those is generally they don't make it any farther up the chain past helium. They will fuse all their hydrogen to a point where they're making so much stuff on the inside and it's causing so much pressure on the outer layers that their gravity can't hold them together anymore. And so they like pop and they lose all their outer layers. They fly out in the universe. And they look like that. They look like a big cloud of stuff. They're really, really cool. So all that pinkish purple stuff you can see in there is mostly stuff like hydrogen. Very, very common element in the universe. About 70% of all of the stuff in the universe is hydrogen. You might not think that walking around here on the Earth, but we have an above average amount of not hydrogen here. And all that green stuff you see in there is oxygen molecules. Oxygen atoms that have been bonded into molecules of O3 or ozone. And they look that green color when they're glowing.
Yeah, this is a special treat because you can find this one with binoculars or a small telescope. This is part of the Messier catalog, where that's one of the most accessible deep sky object catalogs in the night sky, essentially. Some of them you can even see with your naked eye, which is pretty cool. But the Demvel never disappoints. It's also called the Apple Core Nebula because it looks like an apple core. Someone has.
I haven't heard that before, but it does look like an apple core. You are completely correct.
Yeah, so I like that one. I think
the
it's.
The more you know.
Yeah, the more you know. A very oxygenated apple.
A very oxygenated apple. That's true. There's probably much more oxygen in this thing than in most apples, I would say.
Yeah, I think so too. So we have a question from Cody Halfmoon, and we were both asked, me and Wesley, what is our favorite constellation? And I went to see that one. So the thing is, we'll tell you our favorite constellation, but we can't see full constellations in the plane wave field of view. So with the plane wave, we're looking at super tiny parts of the night sky. And constellations are really, really big parts of the night sky. So we can't find a whole constellation and show it to you all at once.
I can hold my book up to the camera. And here, Claire, what's your favorite constellation?
Mine is Corona Borealis. It has really just cool. set, actually. It's more of a summer constellation / early spring. Let's see. Yep, it's that little, like, upside down U shape one. It's supposed to be the crown in the night sky, or the northern crown. There's also one in the southern sky. It's my favorite because it's like one of the only constellations that looks like what it's supposed to look like in the night sky.
That's a good
constellations
point.
Are very abstract.
They, I like to think. They're a bunch of really awful stick figures.
Yes. Although we kind of have to hand it to the ancient people who came up with them, because the stars in the sky is how they kind of have like their little Netflix watch parties at night.
That's a good point. Thing. Yeah, they didn't. No. They didn't have Game of Thrones or Squid Game or anything like that. And
yeah,
they had the stars. Year four.
Yes.
Here's so. My favorite. Mine's also down. This is Scorpius. This is my favorite constellation.
I love it.
I like it a lot because both the Greeks in, you know, like 1000 BCE, 2000 BCE. Very, very long time ago, 3,000-ish years ago, saw this group of stars look like a scorpion, and it kind of does. There's like the tail there, and it kind of sort of looks like a scorpion up here. It's a lot easier to see when you're looking at the night sky, but we can't do that right now. But also the Maya civilization in North America, or Central America, kind of, you know what I mean. Also saw that same group of stars as a scorpion, despite the fact that these people were displaced by about 2,000 years and several thousand miles and an ocean. And they both looked up at the night sky and they were like, yeah, it kind of looks like a scorpion.
Nice. I love that so much. I think there's a similar thing with the constellation Orion as well.
Oh, yeah. There super yeah. is.
So
and
cool.
Same thing with the Pleiades.
I love that.
Like, literally everyone everywhere is like, oh, yeah, there's seven of them.
That's amazing. So cool. So we have another question. What is that very bright object by the moon? Is that Venus? Yes, that's Venus. It has set for us. We won't be able to look at it through the telescope, but you are totally right. That is Venus. So we have another request for the telescope.
It looks like that might be Saturn tonight, actually. At
really?
Least according yeah. to the comments on the spreadsheet from
Okay, now the moon is close to Saturn. Okay.
So maybe Saturn. And soon it will be close to Jupiter, according
Very
to
confusing.
one of our coworkers that wrote this here. Maybe so one of our bosses.
It was Venus the last couple of nights. Now it's pretty close to Saturn and soon to be Jupiter. So it evolves over time as the objects move.
And as we move, and as the, you know, it's all of the perspective is changing constantly.
Definitely.
Dylan, could you move over to Andromeda for me, pretty please?
Nice. The Andromeda Galaxy.
It's really, really cool. We're just going to be able to see basically the core, and you're going to be able to start pretending you can see some of the arms, but not really. Because it is a really, really huge object, because it's very close to us. This is the closest thing to us that is an actual galaxy. Jacob Irish will skin me alive if I don't mention that the large and small Magellanic clouds are technically closer to us and are dwarf galaxies, and so he will hit me with a very big rock if I say that Andromeda is the closest galaxy to us. It is, but don't tell Jacob that I said that, because the large and small Magellanic clouds are closer to us.
I'm pretty sure you're right, but there's also a ton of other dwarf galaxies in our little local group.
Yeah, but those ones don't count. It's a dwarf galaxy. It's They're not big enough. They're nothing like this. This thing is huge. This thing's even bigger than our galaxy.
It is
the wildest thing about it.
It's
hurtling towards us at 500 miles a second.
Yeah. Pretty good.
It's really, really fast. It's about 2.2 million light years away from us, which is 13 million, million, million miles away from us, give or take. Which is very close. That sounds like a big number, but it's really, really close to us, I promise.
Super close. Incredible.
When you're talking about billions, literally billions of stars, the distance scales get a little large.
Definitely. Yeah. So we can see that nice big blob thing in the center. That is the core of the galaxy. That's where lots of the stars are, even a supermassive black hole. And then we have some of that wispy filament spiderwebby looking stuff kind of on the outskirts. That is going to be some of that gas and dust creating that very fun interstellar extinction. So that where that gas and dust is, that's where we're going to see lots of star formation in this galaxy, where other planets will be in this galaxy, which is pretty cool.
And that looks like we may have had some smoke overhead now. I'm going to wait for this cloud. Next exposure to come through.
We'll tell you about the weather conditions we're dealing with tonight. So overall, it's fairly clear. We are dealing with a few wispy clouds, which looks like this is what this is.
Someone who I think is Curtis just messaged me that there's a cloud in the way and it's not smoke, which is, thank God.
But also, Flagstaff has been undergoing a series of controlled burns around the city of Flagstaff. And so we've been pretty smoky the last couple of days, and sometimes that can affect how we look at things through the telescope. So hopefully that won't be super impeding on us tonight, but that is something that we've had to deal with in the past and will in the future, because we live in the Southwest and fires are prominent. So something that astronomers just have to deal with. Not too bad, though.
Yeah. Dylan, can I get the moon, please, my good man?
The moon looks beautiful tonight. Crescent moons are my favorite, if we can even have a favorite.
Me too, because that means there's less of it. The moon is an evil rock. I hate it, and I will be blowing it up as soon as I can.
Yes.
I kid. I like the moon a lot. It's very, very pretty. It just occasionally messes up observations pretty frequently, and so excluded by visibility filters. I guess it's really low in the sky. There's a chance that there's a tree in the way right now, which will make me very sad.
Oh, for once I want to see the moon. We might have to, see something.
Oh yeah, it looks like there's a. It looks like there's a tree in the way. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, or maybe it's just overexposed because yeah. So Dylan's currently. I don't think you guys can see this because it's just a little off the side. But Dylan's cranking the exposure down literally as low as it will go so that we can see this. The gain is on 1%, so it's letting about 1% of the light through. And the exposure time is just about what it is for your tiny puny human eyes.
Yes.
Just very slightly longer than that. But it looks really pretty.
It does.
I think we can... That's not quite the Sea of Tranquility. It's a little...
No, that is. It's right there.
Is that the Sea of Tranquility?
That little guy.
Yeah, it's that one up there. Yeah. Okay. We can just barely see it. But this is the moon.
Yeah. All of those darker patches on the moon are ancient lava fields, which the moon doesn't have volcanoes like we recognize here on Earth with Mount St. Helens or Mount Rainier or the San Francisco peaks if you're here in Flagstaff. It doesn't have big mountains that spew lava. Instead, what these are big giant rocks that have hit the Earth, or sorry, hit the moon in the past, and that created a lot of heat energy down into the core of the moon, and it created a shockwave lava flow back up to the surface. And so those seas, we call them mariae, are just old impact basins that have been filled up with lava. So pretty cool. That is the
Yeah,
moon crust, though.
it's really cool.
Yeah,
It
lots of
also has a
energy.
bunch of really nerdy names for everything on the moon, which is my favorite thing.
Very true. All right. So
Like
we're
each one of
gonna
these individual craters has its own very silly name. I love it.
go to
Oh, also, by the
Jupiter.
way, we
Oh.
have a lunar eclipse stream next Friday
Yes,
at
sir.
12:15 in the morning, Flagstaff time. If you are interested in seeing a, is it a lunar? Yeah. If
I'm
you're
partially
interested in
lunar
seeing a lunar
eclipse.
eclipse, it'll be really, really cool.
Yeah. Definitely join in, especially if you're up. But you can also always watch it later. It'll be on YouTube
This is
forever.
also
So
very true.
don't worry about getting up for that. But we're gonna hop over to the planets next, which are very close to the moon, some of them at least. We're gonna go to Jupiter first. Let's go to Jupiter first. So we have a request for both. So we're gonna go to Jupiter. We're gonna keep it on video mode because Jupiter is also a super duper bright object in the sky. And the less light we let in from that object, the better we can see details on the surface or atmosphere of that planet.
So you can see all these different layers of gas on Jupiter's surface atmosphere. It's a little weirder to define what is what for things like this, because it is just a big ball of gas. Like
Yeah.
here on Earth, we have, the ground and an atmosphere where stuff is like very clearly differentiated. This is just a big ball of atmosphere. At some point in there, you get far enough into the core that there's like just molten hydrogen at some point. And that's kind of surface-ish.
Kind of surface,
But
yeah.
I think the way that they define the surface of gas giants is that it's just the same as their atmosphere, I think. Do you know?
Yeah, I think so. It's made out of essentially the same elements that the atmosphere is made out of. So lots of hydrogen, a little bit of helium, and some trace other elements like methane and ammonia. But as far as I know, we think a lot of it is li liquid, or yeah, metallic hydrogen, some sort of liquid hydrogen like that. There's a possibility that there's this very small rocky icy core, but we're not really sure just because we can't ever like go down into Jupiter and explore it because we will
Get
be crushed
completely
by,
obliterated by gravity
yes,
first.
totally obliterated. Also will burn up and turn into ash particles
Yeah.
because it gets very hot down in the center of these big planets. So pretty hard to know, but geophysicists try to figure it out based off of what we know about the mass of the planet, what it's made out of, the history of formation of other objects in the solar system, especially around Jupiter and Saturn. So we can guesstimate, and usually that's pretty correct for as much as we know. Oh, do you want to answer that question?
Why is Jupiter so blue? I would imagine it's just an atmospheric thing at the moment.
Think so, yes.
Yeah. So basically, we have a whole bunch of crud here on Earth between us and Jupiter. And so sometimes things look a little funky. And we have ways in astronomy of correcting for that, but normally the ways that we can like perfectly correct for it are the sorts of things that take multiple hours, maybe multiple days of observation in order to get a picture that doesn't have any sort of chromatic stuff happening to it from our atmosphere.
Just an update. Cecilia said that she supports the moon slander.
Thank you.
Cecilia
Thank
is
you,
a colleague.
Cecilia. Yes, the moon
We
is bad.
appreciate
The
that.
moon does stink. I will be blowing it up.
Nice. So let's go to Saturn next. Let's move on to our next planet. Jupiter and Saturn are extremely similar in size. Jupiter just is a little bit bigger than Saturn, just a little bit. So. But Saturn's cool because it has the really bright reflective rings. All gas giant planets,
Are
same.
they similar in actual size or just like visually? I
I'm
thought
pretty
Jupiter was
sure
a
they're
lot bigger.
similar in, like
I know Jupiter's
physically.
much more massive than Saturn, but
Maybe I'm incorrect, but I'm pretty sure they're like not that far off from each other in their actual size.
I will consult my little book.
Oh, perfect. So this is Saturn. We can see those beautiful ring systems. Now, the rings are made out of ice particles. So ice like we have here on Earth, with a little bit of dust and rock mixed in. And that's what makes them really reflective. So ice is super reflective out in space. Rings are made of ice, also really reflective. So other planets also have ring systems, but it's mostly made of stuff that's not very reflective. It's pretty dark. So we don't see them as much as or as well as the Saturn system, which is pretty cool.
You are totally right about their sizes, by the way.
Thank
Jupiter's 11 times the diameter of the Earth, and Saturn is about 9 times the diameter of the Earth.
That's
But
fairly close.
Jupiter's about, I'm not going to do the math in my head. Jupiter's a lot big, a lot more massive than Saturn is. Jupiter is really, 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 really massive.
Okay, good to know. Good to know.
But they're about the same size. That's weird.
Yeah, that is it's interesting to think about. Always think
Yeah,
about.
it's weird how stuff like that, because Jupiter is larger than some of the smallest, its diameter is larger than some of the smallest stars that we know about. But obviously it's not a star. It doesn't have enough mass in it to be a star. I think Jupiter would have to be like 8 times more massive to be a star.
It's pretty massive.
That's the figure I have in my head. Some people think Jupiter's like a failed star because it couldn't siphon off enough of the hydrogen in our solar system to become a star. Our sun sort of ate its twin in the womb is what some people think.
I think that's kind of interesting because it never like tried to be a star in the first place. It's not like it went through
That's what you
thermonuclear
said.
fusion in the first place and then failed. So like, is it really a failure if it didn't even try?
I don't think it's
No.
a, well, that's more of a metaphysical question than
Oh,
a
okay.
I don't feel qualified to answer that personally. I
That's,
don't
I
want to.
mean, totally fair. Totally fair. So that's Saturn for us,
That's
almost on
Saturn.
Jupiter. Yeah.
That's
So
really cool.
I
All the
know
rest of
I
the gas giants also have, you may have said this while I was
did.
in my book. I won't say it again then. Cool. Never
Well,
mind.
one really cool thing about Jupiter, talking about sizes and stuff, is that Jupiter's biggest moon, Ganymede, is bigger than Mercury, a planet. So it's kind of interesting how that works out. That planets can be small, but sometimes they're just this smaller size than a moon because it happens to be formed in a different area of the solar system. So we're going to move on, and I think we have a request for Neptune.
Woo. This will look really tiny, just so you know. This camera is not optimized for planetary imaging, and for things like Neptune and Uranus, it sort of works out just fine for Jupiter and Saturn because they're huge, and super, super reflective, and you can just see them yourself in the night sky. But stuff like Neptune is really, really dim, and so we can't quite get perfect pictures of it, with the equipment the way that it is. You're probably gonna have to crank up the exposure time a lot more,
Yeah,
Dylan,
there we
just so you
go.
know.
It looks like it's just peeking out in the image. There we go. Oh, I think it was the first thing that popped
There it
up.
is.
Yeah,
Yeah,
there
I'm
it
pretty
is.
sure it's that guy right there.
Yeah.
Little blue dot. There he
Now
is.
there's
Aw,
Neptune.
what a cute
Very
little
cute.
guy.
Okay, so now that we have Neptune, I know we have lots of other requests and we're about halfway through our time. And so we're gonna move on. We had a question of what one of the objects, if it was the Bubble Nebula. So the last one we looked at was called the Dumbbell Nebula, so not the Bubble Nebula, but we can possibly look at the Bubble Nebula. We might need a little bit of a longer exposure, but we can try to look at it, or at least part of it. We can see a little sliver of the Bubble Nebula. Oh, looks like there's clouds up at the Bubble
Ah,
Nebula, so we
fooey.
won't be able to see anything,
Okay.
unfortunately.
Just to answer some questions real quick. AZ Forerunner is the camera one shot color? Yes. I also drive a Forerunner and live in Arizona. Does Saturn's size in comparison to Jupiter include Saturn's rings? No. I think if you include the rings, then Saturn actually ends up having a larger diameter.
Oh yeah,
I would
definitely.
have to do the math, but
I think
yeah.
so, for
If Claire
sure.
says yes, that means it's true. Claire knows everything.
I think so. Maybe, I don't
If Claire says that she thinks though, so it means it's true. Claire knows everything. No, don't destroy the moon. Very sorry. Cecilia, I support the moon slander. Thank you.
Amazing.
Our favorite asterism.
Oh.
AW has a question for our favorite asterism. What's yours, Claire?
Gosh, I'm not so well versed in my asterisms, but
Yeah, what technically isn't a constellation,
yeah.
but other cultures think it's a constellation, Claire?
You go first. I have to think about this.
So basically, asterisms are kind of fun to talk about because they are just constellations. It's just that the International Astronomical Union decided they weren't. The International Astronomical Union is a body of astronomers from all around the world that makes decisions about standards that we set in our field. Sometimes those decisions are good. I will let that be the end of that sentence. My favorite asterism is the tale of what we would call the tale of Scorpio in our IAU set of constellations. Polynesian peoples would call the fishhook of Maui, and it's really cool because it looks like a fishhook, and it has some fun stories associated with it. That's my favorite asterism.
I think that is technically a constellation if we're not going off of IAU terms, but
it is, yeah. Well, I mean, asterisms are constellations if you were not going off of IAU terms.
Okay, fair enough. Mine is not like a widely recognized asterism. It's kind of one I just made up in my head. So there's a constellation called Aquila the Eagle, and to me, it looks like a stingray. So I say it's the stingray.
That's how constellations work.
In my mind, that's an asterism.
That's as valid as any other constellation anywhere else. So.
It looks more like a stingray than an abstract eagle, so that's what I say.
Chat, I'm being told that you're very concerned about Triton. That little dot next to Neptune is Triton.
Yes, that is Triton. Okay, perfect. That's my favorite asterism, though. The stingray of Aquila. So you can use that next. We have another question for, can we see deep sky objects with an introductory telescope like a 70 millimeter? Definitely you can. Certainly things like star clusters, even globular star clusters, things like M13, M15, you can see the Andromeda Galaxy because you can see the Andromeda Galaxy with your naked eye. So you can at least resolve a little bit more light with the small telescope that you have. You can resolve the moons of Jupiter, which is pretty cool. The rings of Saturn very slightly with that kind of telescope. So you can see lots of things. And definitely the Orion Nebula too. You have a wealth of deep sky objects to your disposal with a small telescope. You don't need anything big or fancy to get started with, or you don't need anything big or fancy at all. You can just enjoy what you have.
People on the scopes, is there, the red dot in the frame is a hot pixel. That is just a single pixel that has gotten too much information and is upset about it.
Nice.
The people on the plane waves, any chance we can see Bubble Nebula now, or are the clouds still gross and in front of it?
Let us see. If not, we have another object that we can go to. We're going to try. Okay.
Sweet. Aw, Hannah, you're so sweet. Dagger One and Debbie Vanatter, hi, are asking about Pluto and whether or not it's a planet. And unfortunately, that means that I will now rant about this for several minutes.
Oh, gosh.
So the reason that the International Astronomical Union, a body of people who make decisions say that Pluto is not a planet, because it is not technically a planet, according to the IAU's definition of planets, is that in the late 90s and early aughts, scientists were finding lots of other planets that were a little bit bigger than Pluto, or lots of other, I guess they would have been planets back then. That was a poor choice of words. They're finding other things in our solar system that were slightly bigger than Pluto, which would have meant, given what we were sort of going off of at the time, that they were planets. The IAU didn't want to have that many planets, and so they came up with a very slapdash definition of planets that is horrible for lots of reasons. Do you wanna go into the planet definition, Claire?
Sure. Yes. So the first one they came up with is that a planet has to orbit our sun, and they did make the distinction our sun, which is a whole other thing, but simply because there's billions of planets that orbit other stars that are not our sun. And so we can't call them planets. We call them exoplanets instead. Just a thing, but they started off with that part of the definition. So the second one is that a planet has to be big enough to pull itself into a spherical shape. The fancy scientific term for this is called hydrostatic equilibrium. You need to have enough mass and enough self-gravity to pull yourself into a sphere. So you can't be a potato-shaped planet, essentially. That one's not super controversial. We like that part of the definition. The third one is that a planet has to clear its neighboring orbit, which is problematic for some planetary scientists because what clearing your orbit means is that you can't have other debris around you that is not technically part of your system. So Pluto has 5 moons, so it is gravitationally dominant of its area in a very real sense because it has a whole moon system. So that's pretty cool. But according to the IAU, because Pluto is in something called the Kuiper Belt, which is a collection of just a bunch of icy objects and icy rocks past Neptune in the solar system. It's a bunch of debris left over from the birth of the solar system. And Pluto's like right in this belt. They said it doesn't clear its orbit because it's around a bunch of other stuff. And that some people are, I don't know. There's a debate because that part of the definition is a little unclear technically what it means. The IAU in some ways didn't define it very well. And also, other planets have problems with clearing their orbit. So
also genuinely no other planet could clear the Kuiper belt of debris. That's just not how that works. Like, it's too big. There is too much stuff there. If you put Jupiter out there, magically it isn't a planet anymore.
That's amazing. Who would have thought?
Same thing with the Earth. There's not a planet. Oh, there's too much stuff there. Oh, I can't be. You can tell that I'm not mad about it. I don't even have that much of a problem with Pluto not being a planet. Like, I own this shirt, so I kind of do. But I don't have that much of a problem with it. I just wish that our reasoning for saying that Pluto was a planet was something a little more sensical than what it was.
Yeah, this is good.
This is the Bubble Nebula, by the way.
Back to topics. So apparently, this is formed from intense stellar winds, which is just particles flying off from the surface of a star around a very young, hot, massive star. And so it creates that little bubble shape around that star. So that's kind of what we can see. So we have things called, we have something called solar wind with our own sun, but stars out in space do the same thing. So we call it stellar wind. It's basically the same thing, just particles flying off the surface because of a bunch of energy. And that's how it creates this nebula, which is pretty cool. So this is a bubble nebula. It's not a very bright one, but it's still cool to look at. It does definitely look like a bubble in the night sky. Pretty nice.
Okay, answering some questions really, really quick. Okay. Dulcimerist, is that galaxy still growing with baby stars forming? Andromeda? Yes and no. There are still some stars being formed in lots of places. The majority of star formation at this point in the universe's age is done. We're like mostly done with it. There's still lots of stellar nurseries around that are still making stars in them, not as much and not as quickly as they used to. It's kind of funny that you say that, because currently Andromeda is not making that many stars and our galaxy is not making that many stars, but in about 4.5 billion years, Andromeda will crash into us, and that will cause a ton of star formation very, 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 very quickly and all over the place as things are smashed into each other. Dulcimerist, we cannot see Comet C2021.
We have a request for an object that we should try because it is a very beautiful edge on galaxy called NGC 891. So let's try that.
Also, EW, we can't show you an equatorial mount telescope and explain how it works right now, but there is some other information on our YouTube page about that.
Yes. So NGC 891, there was a possibility that it might, the building, the Giovalli Open Deck Observatory building might be in the way.
EW, that red stuff above is some other nebulosity. That's just hydrogen gas above it, the like stuff above the actual bubble that this thing is illuminating. The bright star below and to the right is another star. It's not related to this. It just is nearby.
So we're going to try for this galaxy. I think this one is also called the Needle Galaxy.
Ooh,
oh, it's so beautiful.
Needle Galaxy. That's a fun name.
So we're going to do something called a white balance, which you might have seen us doing frequently tonight, which is just using this little box that says white balance and putting it in an area of the screen where we all know that there's only going to be black and white colors, essentially. So like a star and background. And that way we can get the colors of the actual object we're looking at as real as possible. So it's not yellow or green or too purple or red or something. So this is NGC 891. This is an absolutely beautiful galaxy to look at. I just love looking at galaxies edge-on because it shows how flat they are. They're so flat, even though galaxies are some like the biggest things in the universe.
Big frisbees.
this one's cool because we can see that nice little galactic center on the top and bottom. And then we have that nice dust lane, all of that gas and dust, scaring the light from behind. So pretty cool. This is a nice one to look at.
And I think we've got a couple of requests for more planets. So let's move to Uranus next.
Yeah, let's hop on there. I haven't seen Uranus in a long time in the sky, at least through this telescope. We don't often look at it just because Jupiter and Saturn are up, and those kind of steal the show. So
it doesn't, it's not all that visually interesting because it is sort of just a small dot, but it's cool.
It is cool. A cool thing about the planet Uranus is that one of our little astronomers here helped discover the rings of Uranus, which is pretty cool. They did that by basically doing something called an occultation, which is looking at stars and then they appear to like blink out of light. And that's because there was a ring of dust around Uranus that caused that occultation. So that's pretty cool. Looks like it's that guy. Not too bad. Might be a moon.
Yeah, I wonder if that's a moon we're seeing right now. Because that doesn't look like a star behind it. I mean, I don't actually know for certain, but
I don't know either.
Yeah, that looks like a moon. Can someone smarter than me say if they think that's a moon? I mean, you already did, so that probably counts. But telescope operators, do you have any opinions on whether or not that's a moon?
I feel like it is, but maybe I'm wrong. We do have a question for how long will the bubble nebula be seen? Do you have an answer to this question, Wesley?
What is the, let me do some math. Hold on. Sorry.
I love how the answer is math.
The answer to most things is math.
My answer is I have no idea. So,
let's see. Those are its coordinates. What's the sky look like tonight?
Okay, we have while Wesley is doing math, we at least have some word that it is doubtful that that little speck off to the left of the planet is a moon. So likely no. What about the one that kind of like pokes off the side? Is that the one we're looking at? That kind of like makes the planet like a drop shape maybe? I don't know. Hard to tell, essentially. Again, this telescope was not specifically made for planetary observation, so sometimes it's hard for us to get those minute details out. So we're really unsure about that, but that's okay. Sometimes we just don't know what something is. That's the fun of learning. So we have another question about are there any comets visible? So none that are bright enough to see at the moment, especially with some clouds around that we're having tonight. Comet 67P will be up soon. The one that the Rosetta visited, that spacecraft called Rosetta, and it's in the constellation of Gemini, which is usually a winter constellation. That's when it's most known to be up in the night sky. And so it's that constellation has not risen for us yet. So we are unsure, but not at the moment, no comets at the moment. We have a comment, it looks like. So from Tom Sarko, he says, I agree, Jupiter has all those Trojan asteroids. So is it not a planet?
Thank you. No, it's still a planet. That one's allowed.
Planetary favoritism.
Yeah.
People just don't like Pluto. That's what I've always thought. But I guess there's still some unresolved debate in the planetary science community.
What I've heard is that this is bordering on conspiracy theory, but I've heard that the IAU like does some textbook stuff, and so they didn't want to like add that many planets to textbooks.
Oh my gosh.
Or at least they did at the time. I don't know. That's like something a friend of a friend of a friend heard. So don't believe that.
Man, that would be pretty interesting if so. So we have another question. Go ahead.
I think the bubble nebula will be up for the rest of the night, or I'm insane. One of the two. I think the bubble nebula will be up for the rest of the night.
Okay. I don't know. My interpretation of that question was, how long will the bubble nebula in of itself be visible because of that stellar wind?
I have no idea.
Okay. I thought that's what you were doing.
That I cannot even approach answering. I'm very sorry. I would have to do much more math, and math that I am not really qualified to do myself.
Sweet. So just before we answer a couple more questions.
Ooh, let's do, let's go to, Tom Sarko asked for M13, let's go to M15.
Oh yes, please, okay. Really Thank quick. You for reminding me. Sorry. I forgot about that. But while we're looking at M15, if you guys have any last requests, we'll be wrapping up the stream in about 10 minutes. It is a little bit chilly outside for us, so the telescope operators would like to warm up since we've been doing this for 45 minutes, which is pretty good.
Logan Moody, the telescope was made to be able to image basically everything. It's just that you need very, very, very specific kinds of imaging for things like Neptune and Uranus, since they are very far away and very small. You just need, you can't have like this telescope is good for taking pictures of literally everything and will be able to show you stuff like Uranus and Neptune. Cameras built for taking pictures of Uranus and Neptune would literally not be able to show you just about anything else we've taken pictures of tonight.
Oh, this is a great picture of M15. I really like this. Good job, telescope operator. Good job, Dylan. Anyway, this is the object globular cluster, M15. I believe this guy is about 35,000 light years away, if I'm not mistaken.
I think it's 38,000, Claire.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm wrong.
Probably right.
There's approximately 500,000 stars between 300,000 and 500,000. So it's really, really dense in there. And all of these stars are very old. So most of these stars would be super, super red in color if we could resolve that color a little bit more with this telescope, which was pretty cool. These are some of the oldest stars in our galaxy. And they come into these globular clusters because of, we think, something called galactic cannibalism. So generally, when stars form in the night sky, they do not form in such dense clusters. They form in something called open clusters, which are a lot looser than this. There's not as many stars, not as densely packed, but when galaxies eat other galaxies, there's gonna be leftovers, essentially, and these globular clusters are those leftovers of those old galaxies that kind of just sit around in our own galaxy forever until those stars die out.
They're really, really old.
So old.
This thing, I think, if memory serves, this one's 13.2 billion years old. For comparison, the universe is like 13.8 billion years old.
It's
so
old star.
yeah. And of course, like Claire was saying, this thing's like 35,000 light years away from us. So even just the light that we're seeing right now is really old. It left this thing 35,000 years ago. Dulcimer Mist, are any comets visible? None that are bright enough to see at the moment, especially with some clouds. Comet 67P will be up soon, the one that Rosetta visited and Philae landed on.
So we have a couple more questions. Wesley, do you have an object that you would like to go to for like our possibly last objects? I don't know if there are more objects coming our way in the next 10 minutes.
Can we...
Oh,
Dulcimerist has asked for the asteroid series.
Yes.
That's one of Hannah's favorites. Hannah will be very excited
going
and looking at series. Good old one series. I don't think it'll show up in there.
Maybe try online search.
Yeah.
I don't know. We do what we can.
I think
we
Hannah's in the chat right now, and Hannah's like the only one of us that can find series on her own very quickly.
We may have to look up the coordinates for this one again. So it might take us just a little while. It looks like it's above a star in the above the star Aldebaran in the constellation of Taurus.
Here, I've got an RA in deck for you.
Oh, okay.
RA 4 hours, 30 minutes, 46 seconds. And deck is 16:28:20.
Oh, they're entering different coordinates than you said.
Okay, well, those are not, all right, well, okay.
They must have looked it up on their own.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Clearly. Okay, so while we're waiting for Ceres to pop up, we have another question, which is Jupiter's famous red spot, recently read that it is deeper than previously thought. Do you believe that its depth changed or will change over time, along with the width? I'm pretty sure the width is changing, like it's getting smaller, like width-wise, it's getting smaller. I don't know about the depth though. I have not personally investigated very much into the depth of Jupiter's red spot. That's a good
The
question.
coordinates I found again for Ceres are 4 hours, 30 minutes, 46 seconds. And deck plus 16, 28, 20.
Perfect. Hopefully that'll allow us a nice view of Ceres. And this will probably be the last object that we go to tonight, just because, again, our telescope operators are out in the cold right now. And truly, I believe that the Giovalli Open Deck
Sounds
Observatory is the coldest place in Flagstaff. So it's extremely cold up there. You're kind of
It is
out in exposed air.
absolutely freezing. Yeah, you're like at the top of a hill, and so it's like you're getting just everything blowing at you all the time.
Yes.
It's cold up there. It's very cool, so it's worth it, but it is
Yes, it is super
cold.
cool. Don't be daunted by the cold.
Please do not. Please come see us. We would
Yes.
love to have you.
Yes, definitely. Well, this is the asteroid series.
This is the first one found. It's one
That's
series.
true.
They name asteroids with numbers. You used to get to then also call it a thing. You used to get, like, it would have a number and then you would give it a name. They don't do that anymore. Now, if you find an asteroid, they just add another number. And I think we found Ceres in, like, the 1700s. We found Ceres a very long time ago, like, well before Pluto, and I think before even Uranus and Neptune. We've known about asteroids for forever, and it literally just means the name means star-like. Asteroids are nothing like stars, but if you live in the 1700s and don't know what anything is, and you have a telescope that's probably worse than the binoculars that you might keep in your car nowadays, you might look through your ancient telescope and be like, yes, that kind of looks like a star. We'll call it star-like, because that's how they
Love
named everything.
it. Didn't Sirius used to be a planet back in the day?
Did they used to call Ceres a planet?
I'm not sure. You know, I don't know. That's why I was asking if you
I bet
knew.
they would. I don't know. I just know that it's one, so it's the first thing we decided to call an asteroid once we
Fair enough.
had figured
Fair
that
enough.
out. But we might have decided to call it a planet.
It was once.
The point is, all of this stuff is super arbitrary for the most part in terms of like what we decide to call it.
We have a final word on that speculation. And yes, it was once a planet. Nice.
Fantastic.
Amazing. Well, yes, Wesley is right. Everything is arbitrary. You can make up your mind about what Pluto should or should not be in terms of its definition. Because honestly, planetary scientists have not yet made up their mind. So
It's
open
true.
air. Yeah. But anyway, we're gonna wrap it up tonight. So we want to thank you all for coming out to view us on the interactive stargazing. And we'll come back on the first Tuesday of next month, as long as weather allows. Check our website for new updates. General admission is coming soon, on November 15th officially. So
Woo!
plan your night at Lowell Observatory. We'll be open officially to the public in a
Come
less
say hi to Claire and
restricted
I.
way. Yes. Yeah. Well, all good things. We're really excited to see more people now. I know I'm super excited to have more people at Lowell Observatory. It's an amazing place. And I know Wesley mentioned this earlier, but we do have a partial eclipse stream on November 19th, I believe, if I got the date right. So check our website, check our YouTube page, but we want to thank you all for coming out tonight, and we hope you have a good night. Stay warm, everyone who's outside.
Have a good one, everybody. Thanks for coming.